Welcome to Daily Conversation. This is Mr. K.
Eric.
Yeah, today is the 27th of November, 2021. And the time now is 6:17 a.m. Well, today is a reading session and we are going to continue reading the book Eat to Beat Disease. Right, so before we get started, please click the like button and subscribe to our YouTube channel. All right, so here we go.
The DNA repair system springs into action as our node has limits the ripple effect of any damage that has occurred. So it puts the brakes in the cycle of replication, which cells use to copy themselves, including their DNA. This ensures that damaged DNA is less likely to pass on. If there is just too much damage to fix, the cell can trigger its own demise through a process called apoptosis, a special self-destruct program that leads to a cell's death when it's no longer able to serve its function in body.
It is worth mentioning that biotechnology companies are exploring ways to tap into the DNA repair process used by bacteria to create new genetic treatments for a whole host of diseases in humans, plants, and even insects. This is known as CRISPR, pronounced as CRISPR, which stands for cluster regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats. CRISPR is naturally found in about 50% of bacteria and is used to cut out and remove foreign genetic elements as part of the bacteria's own defense system. Scientists have discovered that this cutting mechanism can be adapted to edit human genes. In other words, it can surgically slide out disease genes to inactivate their abnormal function, so that normal healthy genes can be biotechnologically put in their place. When the CRISPR system was published in 2012, it immediately transformed the genetics industry because it is so much more accurate, adaptable, and nimble than any other known genetic modification system. While the promise of CRISPR for treating human disease is still on the horizon, it is already being used as a powerful tool for studying genetic engineering.
The second DNA health trends, epigenetic change. Contrary to popular belief, your genetic fate is not fixed at birth. Quite the opposite. While the DNA code itself doesn't change, specific genes can be turned on and or turned off based on the influences you encounter in the environment. This includes what you breathe, touch, and eat during the course of life. Based on this phenomenon, there is another way DNA can protect your health. Epigenetics, the Greek prefix epi, means from our birth or nearby. You can think of these environmental influences as the factors above the genes that control the expressions of proteins or protein-making function of the genes.
Epigenetics answers the question of why every cell in our body has the same DNA, but we have so many different cells with different functionality. The tissue environment around each cell is unique from organ to organ. For example, heart cells express the genes that allow them to generate the electrical current that creates a heartbeat and pumps blood to the body. Genes in the heart are influenced by the microenvironment around heart cells. Cells in the human retina, which is located in the back of the eye, use their DNA to produce protein that recognize light and transmit a signal that our brain interprets as vision. The retina cells are guided by their immediate environment, as well as by the influence of light itself. Remarkably, both heart and retina cells are using the exact same DNA source code, but the parts they use are different. And this is determined by their organ microenvironment and what the DNA needs to be able to accomplish.
The last words. This is pronounced retinal, and you pronounce
retina.
You pronounce retinal. And the first one is the pronunciation, and the second is the stress. The stress is more on the first
syllable, right? Yeah, so it's retinal. Retinal. Retinal.
Epigenetic expressions are not fixed, even if it's a single organ. The DNA responds to external influences from inside and outside of the body, depending upon the circumstances, stress, mindfulness, sleep, exercise, and pregnancy are just a few internal circumstances that have an epigenetic influence. Some of the external influences that can, for better or worse, epigenetically change your DNA's activities for the foods you eat and what you drink. Active found in plant-based foods and in tea or coffee can epigenetically influence your DNA in a positive way. Chemicals found in highly processed foods can influence your DNA too, but negatively. Due to epigenetics, helpful genes can be amplified and detrimental ones can be blocked.
Okay, the last second line, the highlighted words, which is the first pronunciation should be that, and you pronounce as detrimental, should be detrimental.
Okay, detrimental.
Yeah, and also the second line, the third words, yeah, this is external, so the stress should be on the second, and you pronounce as external. External should be the correct pronunciation.
External.
Yeah, and also go down two lines further, which is the fourth line, the fourth words. Yeah, this one is the opposite of external. So external. So this one should be internal. Stress also on the second.
Okay.
Forms of epigenetic change. Diet and environment can cause epigenetic change, but understanding how this works is tricky. Methylation and histone modifications are two forms of epigenetic change. Through these mechanisms, DNA protects health by making the right genes active or the wrong genes inactive in response to stimuli. Let's first look at methylation.
Remember the spiral staircase descriptions. The two parallel rims of the stairway are DNA's backbones, while the steps are made of the lateral pairs AT or CGs that connect the rims. These pairs are like the key of a zipper, running along the entire length of the DNA. When DNA is used, specialized cellular mechanic machinery unzips the DNA and reads the T, which contain the source code instructions for making proteins. The methyl groups is a chemical cluster, CH3 for science, junkie, that can be drawn into the zipper as it's been read. It's called methylation. Methylation changes the way cells read the DNA instructions. Hypermethylation occurs when a lot of metal groups are thrown into the T, creating interference or form of DNA supported. The zipper can no longer be read in the area, so any proteins that the sections of the DNA is responsible for are not made. In the case of harmful proteins, this epigenetic change can stop that protein from being made, which is good things. As with most things in biology, an opposite can also happen. For hypermethylation, this is when metal groups that normally keeps a gene under wraps is removed. Suddenly, that part of the zipper is free and the gene can make a lot of the proteins. If the proteins is now unleashed, is a beneficial protein such as one that suppresses cancer, is a good thing.
Yeah, there is a word which is 6-9. Yeah, the ninth line. Yeah, but I'm checking for the pronunciation.
Sabotage.
Yeah, this one should be sabotage.
Mm.
Yeah, and I forgot your pronunciation.
I pronounce sabotage.
Yeah. So the last syllables should be touch.
Sabotage.
Sabotage.
Yeah. Histone modification is another form of epigenetic change that scientists are talking about. Like methylation, this modification makes certain genes more or less available. Histones are proteins inside a cell that are folded into bowl-shaped structures. DNA coils itself around these histones. A strain of DNA has multiple histones, so that the strain resembles a climbing rope with thick histone knots tied throughout its length. Special enzymes help unwind DNA from the histone knots, so the protein-making machinery can read the source code. Chemical groups call acetyl groups can be added acetylation or remove the acetylation from the histones, changing their shape.
The result is that different genes can be exposed or hidden, so that more proteins or less proteins made by the cell. Neither hiding not exposing the genes that inherently helpful or harmful to health. The effect depends on the specific genes and whether they create beneficial proteins or harmful ones. If a gene creates a beneficial proteins such as maternal suppressors, unwinding the DNA protects your health. If a gene has a harmful effect, then the benefits come from winding the DNA back up.
Yeah, the last line, the last five words. The last line, the first words. This is winding, and you pronounce as winding.
Okay. Winding.
A third epigenetic change involves microRNA. While DNA contains the actual source code for proteins, in the process that creates proteins, the code DNA is first converted into a template called RNA. Ribonucleic acid. RNA does the actual work of making proteins, but there is a special group of RNA called microRNAs, which float around and interact with the main RNA template to control the making of using useful proteins. It's thought that microRNAs control at least 30% of genes that make these proteins.
Let's summarize epigenetic as simple as possible. Methylation silences genes to thwart making proteins. Demethylations help genes make proteins. Acetylations uncoil DNA and allow genes to make proteins. The acetylations tightens the coil and hides the DNA so less proteins make. MicroRNA can selectively turn off making specific proteins by interfering when RNA templates. Epigenetic influences on DNA is a hot area of study, especially when it comes to diet. But before I tell you what happens to food, it's instructive to see how other lifestyle activities influence our genes through these changes.
Most healthy activities create positive epigenetic changes. And we now are realizing that this is how they bring us their benefits through our genes. Exercise, for example, causes epigenetic changes that free up our genes to make useful proteins for building muscles, increasing the pumping capacity of the heart, growing new blood vessels to support muscle expansion, and lowering blood lipids. Other epigenetic changes from exercise can block harmful genes. These are seen after swimming, sprinting, interval training, and high intensity walking.
Studies in lab rats show that exercise raises DNA activity in the brain. This happens because of epigenetic changes to histones, acetylations that free up DNA, so more proteins can be made to maintain brain health. The DNA impact of exercise goes well beyond the health of the person doing the workout. Men's working out effects are spurned in a way that can influence their progeny. A clinical study from the University of Copenhagen studies the epigenetic consequences of a one-hour spin class led by a certified instructor taken 5 days a week for 6 weeks. They looked at effect of the exercise on the sperms of healthy male volunteers in their early 20s. The researchers collected ejaculate from the men to analyze the sperms before the study, after 6 weeks of spinning. And then after 3 months without exercise, the spin class caused a lasting genetic change in one genomic hotspot, the specific area of sperm DNA that is responsible for the brain functions and nervous system development of the as yet unconceived fetus. Thus, a man's workout routine can be beneficial to the brain health of his child, of his children, long before they are even conceived.
A good night's sleep causes epigenetic changes in DNA, and so does pulling an all-nighter. But one is good, the other bad. A study by researchers from the University of Iceland and Uppsala University in Sweden studied 16 young, healthy men in their 20s and examined their DNA after a night of sleeping for 8 hours, a good night's sleep, followed by a day of total sleep deprivation, all-nighter. Blood was collected before bedtime on the night of sleep and before breakfast the next day after either 8 hours sleep or after total sleep deprivation.
The last fault line, in the middle, the words which is examines, and you pronounce examines. Which is the third syllables, and also the stress fall on the second, not the first.
So examine, right?
Yeah.
Examine.
The study showed that 8 hours of sleep turns on genes that metabolize fats and prevent obesity, while sleep deprivations interfere with those genes. Inadequate or short sleep duration increases the risk of obesity in children by 45%. The epigenetic effect of sleep is profound. A single night of sleep deprivations can epigenetically interfere with as many as genes, preventing them from being used to make proteins, including one gene that is the thermal suppressors. That's a bad thing. When you silence the genes that block cancer, this can increase your risk of developing thermal.
Meditation causes beneficial epigenetic changes that lower the activity of genes associated with inflammation. On the other hand, stress epigenetically unleashes DNA that is associated with inflammation. People who experience severe trauma and who has post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, have been shown to have many detrimental epigenetic changes in their DNA.
Environmental hazards have been linked to epigenetic changes since in patients with cancer, autism, depression, schizophrenia, Alzheimer's disease, autoimmune diseases, diabetes, inflammatory bowel disease, obesity, and a host of other serious health problems. Naturally, it's important to reduce the exposure to anything that could have deleterious epigenetic effects. At the same time, dietary interventions can tap into your body's capacity for positive epigenetic change to activate genes that are beneficial to health.
Yeah, the last line, the first word. Yeah, maybe you. Yeah. And also the second line, the third words from behind. Yeah, this one you pronounce as schizophrenia.
Schizophrenia.
Oh yeah, maybe yeah, too fast. I didn't hear. Yeah. The third DNA health defense, telomeres. Telomeres are the third part of DNA's defense gear. These are the protective caps at both ends of the DNA in chromosomes that help maintain the structure of chromosomes and keep them from sticking to each other. Telomeres are so vital for protecting our DNA that an enzyme called telomerase is continually at work, repairing the telomeres as they naturally shorten as we age. In 2009, Elizabeth Blackburn of University of California, San Francisco won the Nobel Prize for her work on telomeres, the third Nobel related to DNA research. Blackburn discovered that without telomerase, the telomeres shorten quickly. DNA is unprotected, and cells age quickly and die. Her work is brilliantly described in a TED talk she gave in 2017.
The groundwork for keeping long healthy telomere later in our life, however, is laid down in our early childhood. A study by researchers at University of California, San Francisco, showed that breastfeeding improved the length of telomere in the child. In a group of 121 children, those who were exclusively breastfed when they were infants. Had longer telomere by the time they were of preschool age, 4 to 5 years old, compared to children who were formula fed. This shows the durabilities of the telomere effects, that the benefits of breastfeeding remains years after a child is weaned and eating solid food.
On the other hand, telomeres do inevitably get shorter during aging. Studies of people over 65 years old show that those with shorter telomeres die sooner than those with longer telomeres. So research is investigating what behaviors accelerate the shortening of telomeres. Smoking, high stress, poor sleep, and lack of exercise speed up wear on the telomere caps and reduce the activity of telomerase.
The first line, the last bit words, this is pronounced inevitably. You pronounce inevitably.
Oh.
So it's the last second syllables.
Okay. Inevitably.
Inevitably, yeah. So the last second is
Okay. Tably.
And also the last line, last word, this is pronounced telomerase. You pronounce
telomerase. Telomerase.
Yeah.
Let me check the pronunciation, because it seems like it occurs also previously.
Telomerase.
Yeah, so actually I take the other pronunciation from the dictionary. Yeah, and this word occurs a few lines previously, and I did highlight but here it is the second or third time happens. Mm.
What's fascinating is that people that live 100 years old have unusually long telomeres. This 2008 discovery has prompted studies of how lifestyle and diet can lengthen telomeres. These findings are conclusive as to lifestyle. Regular exercise is associated with longer telomeres. Relaxation increases telomerase activity and protects telomere in people who are stressed. And modes of relaxation have even been compared. Example, doing Kriya yoga has a bigger effect on protecting your telomeres than listening to chill out music. Vince Ornish, in collaboration with Blackburn, published their landmark 2008 research in the Lancet Oncology, showing that comprehensive lifestyle changes can improve telomerase protection of telomeres in men with prostate cancer. The benefits that proceeded in a 5-year follow-up study. In addition to telomerase effects, lifestyle changes created an epigenetic effect in angiogenesis proteins that favors suppressing cancer. My collaborations with Dean Ornish in this group of patients, once again, positive changes in the health defense systems were found to be linked.
The second line for this one, I am not very sure, which is the year, and you pronounce it as 2008, right?
Yeah.
So I believe that it is you can pronounce it like 2008 or 2008. Yeah, 2008. Yeah, it's better. Among the influences on telomeres, diet is one of the most powerful. Recall the study of children who had longer telomeres because they were breastfed. When other dietary influences were examined, the researchers found it was possible to shorten telomeres too. This is a negative effect. They found that telomeres shortened in children who drank soda beginning at age 4, and those who drank soda 4 or more times a week had shorter telomeres than those who drank soda less frequently or not at all. The impact of breastfeeding and soda on telomeres is just the beginning of discoveries on how our diet influences our DNA health defense systems. As we will see in chapter 9, the really interesting reveal is that certain foods such as soy, turmeric, and coffee can unleash protective genes while blunting the effects of harmful ones. Some dietary patterns help protect and lengthen our telomeres, including the Mediterranean diet and similar patterns based on it. Before we explore these foods in depth, however, there is one more health defense system I need to introduce to you, the immune system.
Some conditions where DNA defenses are upgraded. Alzheimer's disease. Ataxia, telangiectasia, atherosclerosis, autism, cancer, all types, celiac disease, cystic fibrosis, fibrosis, depressions, diabetes, inflammatory bowel disease, Lyfrauman's syndromes, Lynch syndromes, obesity, Parkinson's disease, post-traumatic stress disorder, rheumatoid arthritis, schizophrenia, systemic lupus erythematosus.
Yep, so we stopped before chapter 5. Yep, so how about I make a summary?
Oh, okay.
Yep, so for today's reading, it's about DNA and especially the part which DNA repair itself, yeah, the DNA repair system. And in the last reading session, we read a part which is the cells can repair. The cells, some of them have the repair enzymes, and then they can actually spot and fix the damage. DNA. And then for today's part, it is another ways, which is like epigenetic repair mechanism. And for this epigenetic, basically it means that the DNA code remain unchanged. And then, however, some of the gene can be turned on or off based on or related to the environment they face, and including foods. Yeah, and for this one, this is the epigenetic, means that due to maybe some environmental factors like what we eat, what we do, our lifestyle, and then the DNA can actually respond to the environment, and they're able to turn on and off for some cells that make the proteins. And then also there is a part which is quite interesting, says that we have the same, we have many cells in our body, and all of them have the same DNA code, but they function differently. Yeah, but this one also is due to the epigenetic factors. And then for this one, epigenetic repairing system, there is two main ways. And the first one is methylation. Methylation is something that can affect how our cells read the DNA instruction. Yeah, so even though our DNA didn't change, but the cells read it differently, yeah, in a different way. And then basically they methylation, they are also two types, which is how they work. The first type is hypermethylation. And for this one is basically interfere the cell reading DNA instruction, and then with the purpose of stop making proteins. Yeah, stop making particular protein. And the other type is the opposite, which is called the hypomethylation. Yeah, which is like to free up the reps of the gene, so make them freely, and then they can make protein. Yeah, and then this is the first method of epigenetic, and the second is the histone. Yeah, through the histone. The histone is actually the proteins inside a cell. Yeah, and also in the last reading session, I came across the structure of DNA, and then it is like inside our cells. So for this one, histone, it is also inside ourselves and also surrounded by DNA. And histones can actually affect it affects how the genes making protein by hiding or exposing them. Yeah, and if they want to maybe stop making particular proteins, they can hide the genes. Yeah, and then if they want to make more particular proteins, they can expose more genes so that they can make more protein. And then also there is a part talk about microRNA, and I think this is something related to DNA and also making protein. Yeah, it is something like RNA is the is the things that actually do the work of making protein. And microRNA control 30% of genes making protein. Yep, and then and next it talks about telomeres. Yeah, telomeres is another thing which is very important when we talk about DNA. Because it is found that the length of the telomeres, if they are longer, and then people live more healthily, and also it is positively related to our longevity. Yeah, and then also there are a few ways can affect telomeres. For example, whether the child is breastfed when they are young, and whether the child drink soda when they were young also, like 4 years old. And there is a part also talk about the benefit of exercise, which you also highlighted. Exercise, good sleep, meditation, yoga, these are the things can actually helps in epigenetic change in a positive way. Yep, so I think these are my summary today.
Yeah. In the past, we actually talk about, we're not sure the benefits, the real benefit of exercise, meditations, good sleep, and having stress like that, and but now we see that actually it can change us biochemistrically or biologically, and yeah, so exercise is important, sleep is important, meditation or some yoga that make you relax, is also important. You cannot have high stress all the time. Yeah, so this is one thing, and the second is this is something in the line 473, and then in the last two sentences, it's actually talk about our DNA activities actually our DNA activities like the beside of the exercise, sleep, meditation, all that, and also foods, diet is also very important factors that affect our DNA, can influence our DNA and cause the genetic change. And also, here the author highlight that the bioactives found in the plant-based foods and in tea or coffees can epigenetically influence the DNA in a positive way. So this means if your diet is a plant-based diet, and then it can influence your DNA in a positive way. But the next line is found that the chemicals found in highly processed foods can influence your DNA too, negatively. And it actually, it made me wonder, because nowadays our foods is become, most of our foods is actually the processed foods. Even though like the soy sauce and also like the butter, and also almost everything.
Yeah, fishbowl, sausage.
Excluding the fresh foods, for example, the fresh chicken, fresh beef, fresh fish, and even though maybe those things they are ground fat, which means they are fats. Grain fat, which is the farmer actually feeds this animal the soil and also some other cereal, and those foods sometimes is also processed foods, especially for soil. And this is something that that we learned from last Monday video review. The soil is actually the processed food. Because it is the GMI, which is the genetically
engineered.
Something like that. So the DNA of the soil have been modified. The genetic modified. And also, we have a trend, which is our meat will become plant-based. We will have the plant-based meat, which is made from soil. Made from soy. So the soybeans, and also some other like the food we eat today, like the rice, the grains, and the fine rice, and also the fine sugar. All of those things, at some circumstances, you can call them processed foods, because this is the corporation industrialized the process. So here the first sentence is called plant-based foods can epigenetically influence your DNA in a positive way. But the next line called the highly processed foods can influence your DNA too. But what is highly? How do you define highly? And also, if you think like that, if you make the meat from soil, wouldn't it call highly? Wouldn't it call highly processed food?
Super high.
So the first thing is about the plant-based foods, what they eat. From the research, from the study, what they eat. What is plant-based foods? Maybe they eat a lot of organic foods. They didn't eat those junk foods or processed foods. So that's it influence their DNA in a positive way. And highly processed foods, we know processed food is bad, or cause cancer. And also, as here, we confirm that it will change our DNA negatively.
Yeah.
And but how about the plant-based foods? Because you see, if you eliminate those processed foods, and then what you eat organic foods, you eat the good foods.
Yeah.
And whether it influences your DNA in a positive way is because you eliminate the processed food, or actually the plant-based food, the organic food actually contribute to the epigenetic changes of your DNA in a positive way. This is an unknown thing.
Mm. Yep.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, so this is my summary for today.
Mm. Yeah, and also previously maybe we thought all of the plant-based food are good, right? Are healthy, and but after the knowing which is called genetically genetically modified foods, also called the GE food. Yeah, we know that not all plant-based food. GM or GE, I think it's also okay. One is genetically engineered.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So plant-based food may not necessarily be good. Unless, like you say, it is organic. Yeah, it's organic, then it will be good. And also high the processed food, I think there are too many in our daily life. Yep. And also something like the sausage, also something like the nugget, the fishball, meatball. I believe that we can eat it like in our daily life. When you go to maybe some restaurant, you can see a lot of meatball. And I think maybe it's time for us to stop or reduce the consume of this kind of foods, this kind of processed food as much as possible.
But how about the rice? How about the flour?
Yeah.
How about sugar?
For rice, I don't know whether you heard of this kind of sayings, which is like they say the rice which is more expensive, yeah, those so-called maybe luxury rice, you can see the price of the rice maybe is like in Malaysia ringgit is like maybe more than 60 ringgit.
Yeah, some of them very expensive, some of them very cheap.
Yeah, some of them is only like maybe 20 ringgit. Yeah, if you talk about 10 kg rice. And they say that actually the higher the price, not necessarily it is better. And some of them is like they are after some modification or some process to make the rice smell good and taste good. And for those cheaper one, maybe they didn't undergo such process, so that the rice maybe is harder and then is not so delicious. So in some degree, the cheap rice maybe is more healthier than the expensive rice.
Yeah, it could be. But I think the brown rice would be more I would contain higher nutrients, right? Higher nutrients than the white rice, or they call the fragrant rice, which is also like the white rice. And also another thing which is it's quite weird, because for example, the patients who who have diagnosed the diabetes. So diabetic person or pre-diabetic person, which is they have the very high blood pressure and also
sugar level.
Yeah, blood pressure and sugar level is high. And also the last thing I forget already. Yeah, in Chinese we call the three high, San Gao. Mm. The last one
cholesterol. Right.
Yeah. It's that one. Cholesterol. And so that this is pre-diabetic person or the diabetic person. And doctors suggest them to eat less carbs, which is carbohydrates. Rice, reduce the consumption of rice. And then so it made me curious if people, let's say if people initially can reduce the consumption of rice, why don't they do that? Only do after they diagnosed the heart disease or very serious disease, obesity and diabetes, so that doctor or nutritionist or physicians start to suggest them reduce the consumption of the carbs.
So in this case, I think the brown rice that you mentioned is a good substitute for rice, right?
Yeah, but they cannot eat more. They cannot eat a lot.
So if let's say for them they not for them, maybe for everyone, if you want to reduce the consumption of what's that? Is the carbohydrate, is it? And then so what could be some substitute? Because sometimes for me, if I didn't eat enough rice and I feel hungry after taking meals.
I don't know. The short answer is I don't know.
Maybe more vegetables.
But you need to eat a lot of vegetables.
Yeah.
If you consider about the calories. Right? Yeah, because vegetables don't contain a lot of calories. And if you don't eat rice, you eat more processed foods. For example, like the plant, nowadays we also have the plant-based meat. But the plant-based meat is actually made from soil. And the meat is not taste good. In Chinese we call the vegan meat. Vegan meat. So it actually made from soil. And also, this is just a processed food. And I don't think that they're healthier than the real meat.
Yes. Yes. And this is what I want to say also. Like when you go into the so-called the veggie restaurant and you see many of the so-called the vegan meat, not only they are highly processed, but also the average flavor of them is basically those seasonings or what. So I think it is even unhealthy. Even you maybe become a vegetarian, you also need to work hard, maybe cook by your own in order to get those healthy diet. It is difficult to get a healthy diet also in the restaurant.
And also in plants, most of the proteins that you can get is from soy or from legumes, which is the beans. So the legume family or the bean family, they contains the proteins or maybe you can eat some nuts. Now, nuts also contain a lot of proteins. But if you look at the main source of proteins, which is the soy, and this is processed foods. Maybe this is not processed foods in some people's definitions. But I think as circumstances, this is, that means if you compare it to some other foods, like the fresh food, you will say it's a processed food.
Yeah, I think it is. Why? Because if you go to some organic shop, you can see they are selling those.
Yeah, organic one, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
They sell those, organic.
The price is very different, right? They are more expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you have anything on the add in?
No.
Okay, so that's all for today's conversation. How do you feel? Did you enjoy the conversations? Please tell us what you think of our conversation. And we are not native speakers. If you found any vocal mistake to be made, please also comment to let us know, because we want to learn more and improve ourselves. Remember to like, subscribe to us. Thanks for watching. See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.